Hello from Secure Cloud Provider. Did you know that generative AI doesn't actually generate anything new? Today we're going to look at the broader concept of AI or artificial intelligence, the subset of that that is machine learning, and then generative AI that leverages machine learning training to be able to, quote, generate something new. Now, before we dive into some of the specifics of machine learning and generative AI, it's important to note what artificial intelligence means, or at least in the context that we're talking about it today. Artificial intelligence is the broader concept that encompasses machine learning and generative AI. Artificial intelligence is the set of technologies that can be implemented in a system that enable that system to then adapt or act like a human. Now, there are caveats to that we won't get into today that relate to, for example, originality. AI is very good at summarizing and at reproducing, but it is not original. And AI also is not good at detecting human emotion, other than according to the parameters that humans have inputted as methods to detect emotion. We won't get into that today, though. That's for another video. For now, it's important to note that artificial intelligence is not an application or system. It's the set of technologies that can be implemented in a system that enable that system to adapt or act like a human. Now, within that broader definition, then, we have machine learning, which is an application of AI that uses algorithms to analyze large amounts of data, to identify patterns within that data, and then to make predictions with machine learning models as outputs. Generative AI has sometimes been looked at as a completely separate branch, but in reality, generative AI really does rely on the training from machine learning in order to be able to generate, quote, new data. Generative AI would be the creative branch of AI, and it's often a subset of machine learning in that it extends the training data using the learning model to produce new and similar content. A really good example of that can be seen in Photoshop. And I really like the term expand that they include here, generative expand. That's really the function of generative AI. So to show how this works, let's click crop over here on the left. And as we drag this over to the left here, we're going to see that we have the option of either inputting something that we want generative AI to produce, which it would do based on training data that has been fed into it, or to simply say generate. If we click generate, what we're going to see here is that based on this training data, which is the rest of the picture that already exists, it creates the remaining pattern to match that. All right, so now that we've established the basic working definition for artificial intelligence, the subset within artificial intelligence that is machine learning, and the extension of machine learning that is generative AI, let's take a look at how that practically works in cloud. What we're going to do is take a look at a machine learning service within AWS, Azure, and GCP, and then at a generative AI cloud service within AWS, Azure, and GCP, examine some of the dependencies, and consider some of the architectural components that need to be addressed. Do you have storage? Are you using a database? Are you using serverless functions? Network requirements are always going to be in place. For example, what are you going to do about private endpoints? What about your role and identity strategy and encryption strategy, etc.? Environment policy is also extremely important, and that takes place at the platform level. And you're going to have policy options for all of the three cloud service providers, but they're not going to be exactly the same. Now, we'll come back to this slide in a minute, but I want to jump ahead here to the caveats, because this is a really important point here. Cloud services are not a simple one-to-one match across different providers. This is a very important point to understand. The distinctions extend well beyond the location and data centers. People often think that, oh, GCP has its own data center and AWS has its own data center. But other than that, we can map one-to-one, you know, S3 to storage, etc. That is not the case. Yes, they have comparable services. However, each of these cloud service providers has their own proprietary control system, unique API frameworks, and distinct environment and feature logic. This extends from each of the cloud services themselves to the platform or the environment where you find the holistic organization controls. We won't have time to examine this within each of the three cloud service providers, but we will take a really brief look at GCP here in a minute. Before we dive into GCP though, let's take another quick look at the table. Keeping in mind the caveats we just went over, that cloud services typically cannot be mapped exactly from one CSP to another, here are nonetheless some comparable services for machine learning and generative AI across AWS, Azure, and GCP, as well as the general service types that will tend to be dependencies across the board. Now, in this video, the objective is not to do a deep dive on AI service APIs and how they differ across clouds, but rather to strategize the approach. In other words, is not the what as much as the how or the process. Now, in thinking through your process flow, will you have a separate specific machine learning model source such as SageMaker that you leverage from Bedrock? How are you going to ensure that you can efficiently promote your models from development to production while still ensuring environment isolation for the two environment types? These are the types of questions you're going to want to ask yourself as you develop your processes, maybe better stated as your system. As we state in other videos, it really is all about the system that you establish, what services you're going to use, how you're going to use them, what dependencies must be accounted for, etc. You need to be able to understand and explain your end-to-end flow and the rationale for the integrations that you include in that process. Now, that overall system is going to be the same regardless of which cloud service provider, or CSP, you choose to use. So the specific services noted here are not the issue. Rather, the process and system are your focus here. Beyond the process and system, though, it is really useful to conduct an analysis of comparable AI services across CSPs. The reason is that even though the services and functionalities are not identical, they are similar, and the types of controls that will be needed for this category of service are likewise similar. So what's useful to do then is to map AI services across CSPs, and then you take a look at what controls the cloud service providers themselves offer for those services. You can then compare those from each CSP and use that list to better understand the risks that these categories of services present. In other words, analyzing the controls that each CSP offers for its respective AI services, both individually and in combination, provides valuable insight into likely risks and controls that need to be present across providers. Now, as noted previously, we're not going to have time to examine all of the cloud service providers, but we are going to take a very quick look at GCP. I'm already here on organization policies, as you can see here. And what I'm going to do is at the organization level, I'm going to do a search for keywords that seem to make sense to gain some insight into what Google considers to be risk based on the controls that it offers. So we're going to do a search on the various terms that would seem likely, such as ML or machine learning and disable non-FIPS machine types. No, that's not along the lines of what we're looking for. Vertex AI is, of course, going to yield some results. What kind of GenAI models do we want to allow? What kind of models in general do we want to allow, right? We could place restrictions on those. And then do we want to disable GenAI Google search grounding, or do we want to specify the GenAI grounding sources? Do we want to define an access mode for Vertex AI workbench, notebooks, and instances, etc.? Okay, so then we can get an idea from this as well that notebooks is going to be another good word to search on. And here we go to notebooks, and we can see, yes, we definitely have some things here that provide some really good insight into possible risks. So access mode, here's where we could define whether we want to restrict to service accounts only for access or to humans, etc. We could also potentially disable the file downloads here or disable root access, right? And we could disable terminal. We could define the environment options, meaning what image, what container images or VMs could be used. And we could require an auto upgrade schedule. So this is not comprehensive by any means. There's a whole lot more that could be done here in terms of actually just researching Google services. We could look at the services specifically within Google and the configuration options. We could look at Google documentation, etc. But we would want to do this across all three CSPs. AWS, for example, as well, right in the organization's policy, gives you an option to disable data sharing for AI services. And Azure and GCP also offer that. This is not comprehensive by any means, but it does give you a really good start into thinking through your approach or your process for how you are going to ensure responsible use of AI. Now, quickly back to our PowerPoint here, I want to go over one more slide. So here in ethics data considerations, we look at the data inputs and the training or the prompt engineering and the tuning, etc. here for the models, and then the outputs, keeping in mind that the outputs are going to have a direct correlation to the data that was inputted as well as to the tuning that took place. Now, specifically in the data inputs, there are some specific concerns to keep in mind. First of all, the consent and use restrictions. You're not allowed to use data in some cases. You would want to make sure that if you're using any customer data, for example, that the customer has consented to that data being used in your testing or in your model development, etc. You want to make sure there's no bias. You want to make sure that it's accurate and also that you have source transparency where that data came from. And then there's also, you know, a lot of other stuff here, clean validated data sets, stress tested, et cetera. In the outputs here, I want to point out one thing, and that is that data sharing consent is very different from data use consent. You might get consent from a customer to use their data for testing purposes to develop good models, but it's possible that they are not giving you consent to share that data. So you're going to want to make sure that all of that is in place as well. And of course, there are a lot of other factors to keep in mind. These are just a few, but this hopefully gets you on your way. All right. Thank you so much. I will see you in the next one. Bye.